Well, ladies and gentlemen, the topic of our next session is building brands in an era of disruption. And our next speaker has a 21-year work experience across FMCG when it comes to HUL, telecom, Nokia and Reliance Communications, and textiles, Raymond. Well, he's a passionate business leader, a very committed professional with a very strong clarity of purpose and objective and analytical power. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome CEO Raymond, Mr. Sanjay Behl.
Thank you so much. I hope I'm audible. It was supposed to be, as per the agenda, a 10-minute tea break. So if somebody wants to just walk off and come back with a tea, that's fine. I have about 45 minutes slot, and I'm going to probably take that to illustrate a paradigm shift in marketing and brand building that we are facing today. I think the topic itself is very, very, very relevant, very, very pertinent topic, and I want to congratulate Anurag, Nawal, the entire team which is organizing this, Jyotsna, to have thought through this very relevant topic of today. However, this is also an era where it's not about just finding the brands which can sell, not actually to buy as the whole theme of the conference is, but there is a disruption which we are going through and which is a hanging sword in times to come for every single brand and every single industry that we need to embrace. And so in a way, it's kind of a dual track brand marketing navigating era that we've got into. Yeah. And that's what really I'm going to be focusing on as I talk. So let me just start by first about what's happening. And most of you would have heard since the afternoon when it started a lot about the challenges of today's marketing, challenges of what we are already going through and the whole thing about how the consumers have evolved thanks to the demographic shifts across the globe, so much in India, the economic situation, how it's growing. We heard a lot of times this whole thing about per capita incomes going up, economy doing well, consumption era, probably towards the end of it's a post-consumerism era there. And with evolution of not just demography, economic prosperity, healthcare trends are changing. Technology has had a very, very defining roles in not just meeting our demands, but shaping our behaviors to expect a very, very different kind of life that we all are living. And so is the whole times change for the consumer. And if you really have to market, this is how the consumer life has really changed. So you see, in the last about 15 years, 20 years, we've probably seen more defining changes in the way customer is living than the 100 years, and you would hear this more and more as we go forward, or you would say the last 5 years probably seen more change than the last 20 years prior to that. And what's happening at the fundamental level, if you look at absolutely the base level of this change, what we are going through is the first thing is that we are packing a lot more in our lives, not just Indian consumer, world consumer. Yeah, technology has actually in a way been a leveler. In a way, a leveler between the developed economies, emerging economies, and yet to be developed or yet to be emerging economies. Technology has been the biggest leveler, and because it has leveled so many things for us in terms of access, products, services, communication, awareness, all these things are getting leveled like never before. So now you pretty much have a serial or a content getting broadcast in India live as it is happening in New York, or you're getting access to products anywhere in the world in 24 hours without having to travel out to get those. So all the things are getting leveled. That's had a dramatic impact on the life of customer. People have a lot more on experiences now. Again, I'm sure some of the speakers would have shared some data around it. Packing so much into our lives, the whole life that my children are living is very different than I live. And I used to revel on the fact that my parents lived a very sedentary life, and I have a super active life, and what my children are living probably is not just hyper, but ultra hyperactive life now. Trying to pack almost everything, not just one holiday, but multiple holidays. The concept of small vacations now, there's a concept of long vacations now. The amount of media fragmentation we've seen used to be pretty much 3 hours of TV, and that 3 hours of TV has pretty much remained where it is, and now there is so much more media has got added. There are doses of small internets that we consume almost through the day. They say about 200 times we all check up our phones in a course of a day, and that's actually the impact of that is yet to be seen because this whole industry is fairly new. Now, as we're doing all that, the fundamental shift which is happening is all of us and our customers are getting less and less time, available time to evaluate, engage to a particular experience is dramatically reducing, already today, dramatically reducing. And as we see, not just that's happening, most of the needs have been almost met. The whole 20th century marketing paradigm was about meeting unmet needs, needs, wants, and desires. Yeah, that's the classical definition there. Saying that find a need, just go there, have a competitive product offering in a gap area, need gap area. So if there is dandruff, find something which gets rid of dandruff. If a shirt has a stain, find something which removes the stain. If there is a lack of a good quality stay places in a tourism place, launch a nice looking hotel at a competitive price, and you have pretty much the business going after, adding to that a dose of other parts of the marketing mix. And that was what was really happening. And as we look at that, now it is no more the needs. There was an era in 80s and late 90s where we've almost got into the post-consumerism, post-needs getting met kind of a phase where the options in each category that we know, each of those need categories dramatically increased. Now I'm going to be using a lot of examples which are in my industry, Raymond, because especially when I build the concept, because there I need a permission of another marketeer there about my point of view. I can give the point of view, is the brand point of view there? Because if I use examples of Indian brands, it's only appropriate that I take permission from some of those people. Or I'll use the media publicized and media announced viewpoint by the chief executive or those marketeers so that we can build kind of a framework of my talk there. So if you look at this category in terms of choice, simply textile category, in about 15 to 20 years, the number of options from broadly 10 brands controlling about 80, 90% of the market, these 10 brands control probably less than 10% of the market. And the number of options from about 10 have gone to over 1,000 options that are available when it comes to clothing yourself. Yeah, so it's a huge number of increase. So it's from a limited option, it's become a huge number of available choices there. So that's one paradigm of marketing. And not just this, every category you see, look at shampoos. I've just given some illustrative categories to bring in the point. Those five brands on the left control 80% of the shampoo market. And today, there are, I don't know, if you really go to the market, this is what you get. The kind of shelf that you see is this. So how do you buy your shampoo in this market of absolutely surplus? There are 800 to 1,000 options, even in a small organized retail today, of shampoos there. One brand has 30 variants being offered there. So the time that customer has, one has come down, options have gone up, and if we don't have an absolutely remarkable product standing out, popping out of this 1,000 option and saying, you know, watch me, observe me, consider me, and buy me, has to go through the entire circle. There's very little that customers really need to do to buy you, to pick up your brands. And that's the challenge that most of the marketers are already facing today, and it's quite a challenge. Look at yoga. I was just looking at some various categories as to how this has exploded, the number of options that have exploded. You know, so the needs are met. Wants are being created by brand and marketeers. And within wants, look at the options which are there. These are yoga books. About 10 years back, if you look for a yoga book, you'll get probably 10 books, a dozen books, maybe two dozen books about yoga. And then suddenly it became a brand in a very, very big way. And suddenly people found a huge economic reason with technology, access to the world, and the number of options. If you go in Google, there are, I think, 15 pages of search you can do in terms of the number of books there. I've just given you some illustration. So a normal brain, a normal marketer would have yoga for women, yoga for men, yoga for every kids, yoga for morning, yoga for evening. But nowadays, we have a good morning yoga, a good night yoga. You have yoga for toddlers, yeah, who don't even know how to walk. There are enough books on yoga for toddlers. How do you get them there? And there are these teddy bear yogas there. In fact, there's a yoga for dogs now. Yeah, it's called Doga. Yeah. So imagine, this: if you are going to find a book on yoga, what do you want to really buy? And there are over 1,000, 1,500 yoga books on every Google page, and there are 15 of those there. Imagine you going to a store and picking up a book there. That's the kind of an era that we've really got into. And in this era, if we really see the earlier times, the whole marketing paradigm, and at least I've been born and brought up and nurtured in an era where it's all about about really putting a competitive product, not a great product, competitive product, but do great marketing around it. And pretty much, if you have enough dollars and enough creativity in marketing a product, you would have a market share. That used to be the era not very long back. And in that, the whole circa, if you see the Moore's idea diffusion curve, it's all about you launch a product, which is a pilot phase, and then there are early adopters, and then comes the real critical mass, of the center, which when the product really takes off and becomes the mass, and that's in a product life cycle is when brand marketeers and the businesses make real money. And then over time, innovations come, and this brand goes for a declining phase. Each category, each brand, each industry really goes through this kind of a dispersion curve, used to. And this is the circa that at least I have been trained and born and brought up in the 90s when I was practicing market and brand person there. This is the kind of things we used to really look at. How quickly can we get into mass extraction of the profits from a brand by making it scalable, making it reach everybody, and being competitive and continuing to launch, relaunch so that the relevance of the brand really, really stays. From that, now the era has moved to a very different kind of a thing. Currently, today, or in the last few years, it's already been happening. Brands which are doing well are succeeding. Brands which are not doing so well are actually facing a lot of diminishing returns on their marketing investments. Today is the era of remarkable products, absolutely remarkable products. If you don't have out of the 1,000 shampoo bottles in a mall, in organized retail format, your shampoo bottle having a real reason for somebody to notice you and then consider you, evaluate value for money, and actually pick up, use it and continuing to use it. If you don't have all of these things falling in place, believe me, there is enough and more that is available in the market, which is satisfying not just the need, the demand, the desire, the aspiration, anything that the brand can fill. So you need, first of all, a remarkable product. And each brand and marketer here and across the community needs to think, what is remarkable about my product? What is the reason for it to exist? Why do I exist as a brand? What am I servicing really in this huge clutter of the market there? Then the second paradigm is that we need to start making money at early adopter stage. I don't think we can wait for the middle of the belly phase there, because middle of the belly is the most unprofitable belly in marketing paradigm today. That's where the options are going up from 10 to 1,000. Because you've already tasted success in early adopter, people have copied you, imitated you, they have launched 30 variants per product in every single category there. And when you get into the belly, it becomes a commodity game and a fight to the price. And it is bound to happen in every category. Take anything, airlines, hotels, this. So unless there is something remarkable, and unless you're really going to be ready to make money pretty much in the first 10% to 30% of growth stage of the brand, the rest is going to be a very, very difficult stage to make the money there. So that's again today. And the third is, we can't afford to have the same industrial TV complex where marketing would mean that, okay, here comes a brand, my target group is SEC AB, and I have 50 million customers to market. Here comes an agency, brief TV campaign, IPL media, or Kaun Banega Crorepati, or whichever programs reach my target group, let's get into that and hope that is going to reach. No, it's not going to do the same job it was doing possibly 10 years back. It's not going to do the same job it was possibly doing last year. Because every passing day, every passing moment, this is becoming more and more ineffective. So clearly, you know that there is a targeted media today, which could be digital technology, but there could be other ways of targeted media at point of sale, in direct marketing, and there are so many other ways of reaching targeted media, which are far more cost effective than the earlier. And it is not wrong to say that TV used to be, and probably still is, for some mass brands, the most cost-effective medium. So it's nothing against television and the thing there. But with that, there is so much more that needs to be done for the effective pie of marketing to give money. But that's really today, and that's how the value really is of the brands today. It comes not at the center, but at the early adopter stage there. So what is the fundamental change which has happened? In the last 20 years in brand marketing, we have seen two things go up. Resources have gone up, because technology and interconnectedness has dramatically improved resources at marketeers and brand people's disposal. Yeah? Today, an access to announcing a product, to make, if I want to make a video, to a communication to 1,500 store managers in Raymond, it's a decision which takes me 10 seconds and an execution time of 2 minutes. Yeah, that's all it takes. 10 years back, it would have been such a Herculean task to really reach. You would have probably have to have a letter, you would have to record your message, put a video on air, people would stream with a very poor quality data, and the whole impact would have gone. Now it's just one touch. Yeah, that's the thing there. So huge amount of resources at our disposal today as a marketer. And I've just taken one example of access that you have. There are everything in terms of money, the return, the mediums, the resources, today crowdsourcing. In Raymond, we're launching a Khadi collection probably in the next 2 weeks now, with 80% of designs are not by designers in-house, but it's been crowdsourced. I have a whole world to design for Raymond today at a cost which is 1/100th of the cost of having a designer sitting inside the company. Yeah? So there are multiple ways to really see as to how resources could happen. And the number of options, as I said, has gone up. One thing which has come down is the time. And that's what really has happened. So fundamentally, the marketing in the last 20 years has really shifted, and most of you are confronted with the current era now, is from identifying needs as a marketer, we move to creating wants. So we are launching products. Now, we didn't need iPhone. Without iPhone, life was good and structure was great and we were communicating. We had all kinds of applications there. But it just came and created a completely different, shaped a completely different planet, because it gave something in terms of the same end benefit, same hardcore point A to point B kind of communication, but it delivered in a very different way, and you want then that product. So this is the era that we've really gone into. And you will hear a lot of this in the conversations. I'm sure you've heard it through the day. Things like conversations, millennials, customization, because if everybody is getting this thing, it's like the challenge we face as a brand, Raymond, of we being the most preferred brand when it came to weddings. Raymond was the accepted code of dressing, or actually suits or Western wear was the accepted code of dressing. And from accepted code of dressing there, it became a hyper-customized market. One, the weddings went from 1 day to 3 days now, so people don't shop for one occasion only for the wedding. People shop for the teen din, mehendi, and this, and the reception, so the number of occasions went up. And within that, the code of dressing changed from Western wear to Indo-Western fusion. Within that, it became hyper-customized. So at some point of time, if you were the odd man out 20 years back, I would say 15 years back, of wearing a strange-looking dress which really didn't mix with the pigeon dressing code of weddings, which is a black, blue, or a gray suit with a red tie, you would feel very odd. Today, if you have even one person wearing what you're wearing, you will feel very odd. It's the other way around. The whole paradigm of clothing has really changed. So how do we customize, personalize? I'm saying these are some of the buzzwords marketers are using, and rightly so, some of them, if you really understand the importance of it in terms of how millennial customers are different and how we can make an experience economy. However, my talk actually in the next 30 minutes is not about today. Yeah, so that is all you've heard, and that's what you're going through, and these are the challenges we go through. That's the first track we have to continue to be on while creating the second track, and that's really the era of disruption. Something which threatens our existence. Something where a brand and a marketeer has to go beyond the call of a duty of looking at his brand and actually thinking in a very different way. And that's what I'm really going to impress upon over the next few minutes of my talk. And that's the first part is to really, there are two parts to this. Building brands, era of disruption. The first thing I want to really do before I come into building brands is, what is era for disruption? What is disruption? Yes, a huge amount of debate there itself. Is disruption about your business model being challenged? Is disruption about a technology infusion in our category, our industry, our brands? Is disruption about a completely new product proposition like Patanjali challenging Colgate and Hindustan Lever? Is that disruption? So what is really disruption? So that's the first thing I just want to spend a few minutes on. And then let's get into, in this era of complexity, disruption, super VUCA, whichever way you want to look at it, what are the principles that we as a community of brand marketeers must adhere to really build sustainable brands and sustainable businesses? So it's going to be a real bit of a 15-minute here and a 15-minute forward. Now, everybody takes this example, and so do I. I take it a little more intimately, this example, because I've been part of this company heading marketing for Nokia in India a couple of years before this came in, 2004 and 5, when Nokia was on a high, and I had a good fortune of actually interacting very closely with not just the regional Asia-Pacific, but the global team and global headquarters and the board of the company, including engagement with their chairman, Jorma Alila, in 2004-05, who was leaving, and that time chairman, Olli-Pekka Patila, which then became Stephen Alok. So I have interacted with some of these people very, very closely with the anxiety about the growth in the next decade of Nokia. This is the cover of Forbes in 2007, which said 1 billion customers. Nokia had a 40% global market share in 2007, and it said 1 billion customers, and it goes on to say, can anyone catch the cell phone king? Can anyone? And by this time, the Apple had happened to the world. Yeah, so iPhone, the first iPhone had launched 4 months before this article. This is September, I think, issue. You can read it, it's September issue, and May iPhone had launched. And after 4 months, this article comes and says, still, but it's their iPhone, but can anyone still catch Nokia? Because it's just too big. It was making phones like 2 new phones a week, and it had a hit rate of at least 6 to 7 phones succeeding, with 3 making spectacular profits for it. That's an amazing rate of success in any technology company. If you can win 3 bets spectacularly, nobody can touch you, and no wonder. I think Nokia was going through the phase, and it had 20 years of great success behind them. And this is 2012, and says Nokia, world leader, bought by Microsoft, got bankrupt. I remember fighting for an acquisition with the board of Nokia in 2005, and you can quote me on this, a $1 billion acquisition of BlackBerry. That time, Nokia's valuation was $86 billion. And we wanted to pick up because BlackBerry was very small then. Push email technology, Nokia was working with Microsoft on pull email technology, which is later why Microsoft bought it, because they were into emails. And look at the dilemma here. Nokia board says that we are already working with the best in email, and you are telling us to buy an email app from some Johnny startup in Canada, a company which don't even heard. RIM, what is RIM? Research in Motion, Canadian companies. Few people in Wall Street are hanging BlackBerry. Is not good enough for a reason to even consider. We're working with Microsoft. Email authority. The only argument we had is that Microsoft's next 5-year plan is not push email, it's pull email. You have to pull it to the phone. And customer is getting, the role of technology is to make customers lazy, so we should have push email. And that will change the whole paradigm. But somehow that $1 billion pill was too hard to swallow for Nokia. And apart from that, we had 2 recommendations on moving away from Symbian, which was the operating software, to a different open source software. Nokia was a very closed software, Symbian, but it had great success. The success itself becomes at times your own enemy, because it has great success in having closed atmosphere. But there is a team which was trying to be rebelling against the success, so it was again hard to swallow. And 5 years down the line, those 2 or 3 reasons itself became part of the reason for the entire downfall of Nokia. May not be the entire reason, but eventually BlackBerry became very big and it got sold for under $10 billion. $86 billion, 5 years, $10 billion. So what happened? And you know what? When you really go to the CEO of Nokia, this is what he says. We didn't do anything wrong, but somehow we lost. I don't even know what went wrong. Just came in. Now here is a global CEO of Nokia who's doing everything right. Huge success, $86 billion every year going up, great phones, all success, 70% success in the model. And then 5 years down the line, they got sold. And when you reflect, in hindsight also, there is no learning. What do we do? Yeah. Look at another example. And now I'm going to run fast once you have the track of what I'm trying to engage with. This is Kodak example. Again, most of you have heard of it, but I don't know how many people know that digital photography was proprietary and invented by Kodak, which eventually swallowed it. It was their technology. In fact, this is the person who invented it. Steve Sasson was part of the technology team of Kodak, who invented digital camera, because one of his, his daughter, at 5 or 6 years of age, just casually on her birthday asked, why do I have to wait for a photograph to come? Can't you just take the photograph and give it to me? That gave birth to Polaroid, and eventually he started working on digital camera. Now that was a harmless query or an anxiety or an ask from his children, and he'd invented, and this, the first digital camera is what he's holding. It look like this. But that's how all the technologies are. They're all ugly, big. Well, today I was there in the afternoon having lunch with a 3D printer fabric person from Manchester, and he brought his technology, and it looks big and bulky, and obviously it's not perfected, but that's how all technologies start. Yeah. And what did he say when people asked him? He's saying, yeah, I know about digital photography, when digital started becoming a little more noticeable. He's saying, it's cute, but don't tell anybody about it. Yeah. And what happens to a company like this? Kodak continues to succeed while digital was happening. And suddenly, towards the end, if you see the red box there on the chart, in 4 or 5 years, from 86 billion digital photographs which are being taken, 86 billion photographs, most of them were on the roles the way it was, it suddenly becomes zero, while the photographs jump to 1.2 trillion in no time. So from 95% of the photographs being non-digital, it becomes 95% photographs. It can happen so quick. And that's when you say, I don't know what happened. We always had this technology in-house. That's the kind of disruption. Now, what does, think about a Nokia CMO, and think about a Kodak CMO. They would be doing all brand tracks, and the brands would be doing phenomenally well. Well, if you get an employment letter and saying you joined the brand team of Kodak in 2003, Kodak return or Nokia return, you would say, wow, man, the offer. I left levers for Nokia as a head of marketing. Wow, what an offer. What a great industry to join. A great brand. It's a world leader. And then you know 5 years down the line, it doesn't exist. And even when it didn't exist, the brand would have done 80% recall, 90% preference, whatever the indicators you see. So how do you navigate this brand as a brand manager or a CMO? And then you say, no, it's not my job. Somebody else would have taken a call. No, it is our job as a leadership team. CMO and brand people are at the center of decisions. And you must need to influence such decisions there. Another example, Blockbuster. Blockbuster was a digital video and rental company. And it's not about the cockiness of the CEOs. Don't get them wrong. I don't think it's about arrogance. I think it's general blindedness. Because there is only that much a human brain can decipher and cognitively be able to analyze. Here is a CEO which gave a comment. Neither Redbox nor Netflix are even on the radar. They're not even on the radar. Forget about being a threat to me. They're not even in the radar in terms of competition. This is a quote given in December 2008 by the CEO of the largest content distribution company in US, and he went bankrupt 12 months later because of Netflix. 12 months. It was not even in the radar. Yeah, and that company, which was not even in the radar, has $70 billion valuation today in the last 7-8 years. 2008, he makes a statement. 2009, he does not exist. Yeah, today's share price, if you check the Google, is -0.01 cent. It's bankrupt, actually. So they're not even 1 cent. So from a huge valuation that company was at that point of time, about $13 to $14 billion. That could happen. So what's happening? Not just there. Is it technology? One can argue it's all technology. It's not technology. It could be products. It could be business models. Look at this. Is it technology? There is no technology in Patanjali beyond what is known to human mankind for ages. But here he comes, and not just one, but multiple multinationals existing for centuries, he disrupts them. And one can argue, is it disruption? Is it explosion? Is it just about getting market share? I think it's really disrupted the market. I was part of the levers, and we had a milestone getting celebrated when we crossed 10,000 crore revenue somewhere towards the end of the century after 100 years of levers existence. I think he did 10,000 in 5 years. Yeah, I understand there is speed to it, but the way they're adding, and they're bold enough to say we'll do 20,000 before the end of this next 3 or 4 years. Now, there is something happening which is shaking the marketeers and the equity and all our brand knowledge that all of us have known as a community in a big, big way. And one needs to watch out. Look at this, again, lots of examples. Yeah, but there's nothing wrong with a black and yellow cab. It takes you to point A to point B, it's cheap, it's comfortable, you can get it at a raise of your hand. Yes, but something else comes and totally it says, okay, end of it. Yeah. So lots of these, anything which has been leader for decades is extinct today. And anything which was born yesterday is becoming leader today. So what's happening? What's the role of you and me as brand marketeers in this era? And lots of them, not just global, Indian examples. So this is the point I just want to leave you with all the talk. Age, size, reputation, current sales, brand equity, intellectual property. Any or all of them, in any combination, used to be the most sustainable competitive advantage for the brand. None of them guarantees our existence today. In Lever, we used to debate aggressively, not very long back. Even today, I'm sure in coffee shops, a debate. What is our competitive edge? What will sustain? And there was always a demand, is it brands of levers or is it people of levers? And there was always this constant, okay, I will retain people because people will create brands. And then there was saying, no. People can come and go. Brands are long-lasting, it's perennials, and they will always get people coming on board and taking them forward. Or distribution. I think one of the critical edge for distribution why nobody could catch levers was an early advantage in distribution in penetrating the small market. So it could be any or all of them. But today, take it from me when I say none of them guarantee our existence. Because I can give you examples in each one of them of Indian and global examples. Take any of them. And I can give you 5 examples as to how the argument doesn't stand. So how do you build brands when brand equity itself is not a guarantee? So you keep investing in brand equity, stronger brand, no guarantee. Tomorrow you can. Yeah, so you won't exist. What do you do? How do you build brands there? Sony, one of the top brands in the 80s and 70s, and we've all grown up to Sony as to how Walkman disrupted the two-in-one market, completely disrupted it, and then it got disrupted by digital music. So you can be a brand of good tide one time, but then everybody has its day. iPhone is having a great ride, or Apple is having a great ride for 10 years. Does this guarantee next 10 years? May not. May not. You may be surprised in 2025 there is a new Apple equivalent emerging, and maybe Apple, if it doesn't continue to obviously do things which are ahead of the times, may not exist. So today, if you have an idea, it could be $1 billion in no time. In fact, it used to be taking on an average about 20 years to build a $1 billion company, not very 20 years back. That is what the time was. To reach $1 billion, you'll need about 18 to 20 years if you're a top company. These companies on absolutely your left, yeah, your YouTubes, Instagram, they took anywhere between 2 to 5 years, and we used to say, wow, what a company, what a brand. The companies to your right have taken under 2 years. Pokemon Go, I know you would have heard about it, just launched about 1.5 years back, did $4 billion in 4 weeks. $4 billion value. Raymond, after 93 years, we cut a cake when we did $1 billion. 93 years it took us to do $1 billion valuation. Yeah, and we celebrated, and the whole company went into a whole rejoice and jubilation. Pokemon Go did $4 billion in 4 weeks after it launched. Instagram or Snapchat, you all heard. Oculus. Oculus founder was 18 years old. 19 years old. He didn't have money to launch that. VR. Crowdsourced money, $2 million. That's it. He crowdsourced. He told all of us, please give money. I have an idea. So everybody gave, somebody gave $10, $20, this, that. In November 2012, I think he crowdsourced the money, or 2013. In January 2015, he sells his company 14 months later for $2 billion to Facebook. Yeah. That's the kind of value getting created. Now, obviously, there is something happening which is making Oculus a brand. Not the CMO of Oculus, not the brand manager of Snapchat, but the brand manager of Snapchat is having a great time right now. He's saying, I manage Snapchat. Something else is happening. So what is happening is what we need to understand there. Yeah, so the companies now obviously are short-lived, and if you're not really getting the mix right, not just the brand, but the whole business mix right, we're losing out. Now one can obviously argue, okay, change has always been a constant, so what's new? In 80s world chain, 90s world chain, this has been my argument to myself. Saying, but yeah, marketers have to be on the center of the customer and holistic and change. Is there something new about this change, which was not there 10 years back, that I have been trained on, I have been conditioned on? The second thing is, managing brands has always evolved. So again, the question, what's new? And these are the very, very valid questions to ask there. So let me attempt and really solve that in the last 15 minutes of my section there. Change has always been constant, yes, but change has been linear. And that is why human mind can decipher the change. Right from years back till about a few years, maybe about 50 years back, change has been a linear equation between the resource you throw and the output you get. One person, X amount of job. Two people, 2X. Three people, 3X. That's the manual labor. You put animals in that. If one man can do this kind of farm, with a horse or bullock cart, we can do double the farm. So double the animals, double the output. Then it became double the machines, double the output. So we know a machine has a certain output. It is going to give me 100 pieces a minute as a garment. If I have 10, it's going to give me 1,000 pieces a minute. Yeah? As simple as that. So it was human mind can cognitive easily decipher that. But there came something called information technology. And everything went topsy-turvy. And it's really in the last 10, 15 years we've started really understanding we still are not able to grasp. My belief is that it's the last 10 years that humanity, for the first time in its evolution, is lagging technology, because we're catching up, and technology keeps running ahead of us. That's what is happening. And why is it happening? Because the whole thing has become that the price-performance ratio of every single thing which has information technology coming doubles every 2 years, which basically means that if I have a drone which can go 1 kilometer at a cost of 1,000 rupees with a 1 kg payload. That's the current price equation, 2018. pretty much with all the technology around that drone, without you and me being there, because of the technology that exists today, in 2 years, it will go 2 kilometers at half the cost and double the payload. That's what is happening. Now, just think about this. It's the same analogy I have used at a couple of forums there. If I take 30 steps right now, the linear steps, and that's how the human mind works, I'll probably reach the end of the room. Yeah. So 1, 2, 3. And all of you here, with an approximation of plus minus 5%, can say where I'm going to be after 10 steps, where I'm going to be after 20 steps. Your mind can comprehend it. And that's what we do, forecast, predict a future history, and we do linear equation, because you know that. But if I say I'm going to take 30 double steps, first step is 1, second is 2, third is 4, 8, 16, 32. And I say, where will I reach? And somebody can probably say, you'll reach end of Bombay. Somebody will say, you'll cross maybe Maharashtra. But that really means that I'm going to be 24 times around the planet. That's what it means. So at some point of time, it's a billion steps. 1 billion steps. It's not 30 steps. 30 compounded is a billion steps. Now, when you compound it, our minds are not attuned to really do it. And that's exactly what happens. So when 3D was printing was launched, or digital photography was launched, it was in 1970s. 1970s, it was 0.001%. It became next 2 years, 0.002. Price performance doubled, cost halved. 0.002 to 0.004 to 0.008. At some point of time, it's going to hit 1. Then it's going to hit 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 120, 256, 1012, and then 2000. And suddenly, 1 to 2000 is going to happen very, very quickly. And that's the exponential curve. So we used to the red, and we've been confronted with the yellow. And that's where, if we are able to catch the curve, it's a great opportunity. If you're going to miss the curve, you're going to be Nokias and the Kodaks and other people. How do we catch it? That's the thing. That's the chain that we're having. Every single industry, every single brand, India, abroad, no, it doesn't matter, will go through infusion of technology, and eventually will go through these 6 Ds that I'm going to talk about. First is digitization. It's bound to happen in every industry. If it's not happening, it's happening to your industry outside your company, somewhere in the shed in Israel, or somewhere. In fact, today, the person I met for 3D printing, which makes fabric redundant, the current process, is actually an Israeli sitting in Manchester and has already patented the technology across the world, and which basically means he can produce at $1 million, $1.5 million, half the output of my Vapi factory. Vapi factory is 800 crores for me. He can do it at $1.5 million, half the output of my Vapi factory. He demonstrated today to us. So somewhere digitization is early. It's probably 0.001 stage for this person. It'll become 0.002, 4, and then we'll have to see when it happens. Could be 3, 5, 10, 15 years, we don't know. And then it goes to, so it's very deceptive. Initially, it's very deceptive. It looks like, arey yaar, dekhte hai na, kya hoga? You know, typical legacy mindset, big brands are saying, yeah, of course, I know, these are good gizmos. You know, there's that whole talk about variables in your T-shirts and all that, which check your blood pressure and all that stuff. Yeah, it's a gizmo, it's been there for 10 years, is doing it, and I can understand at least companies are doing it. It's okay, it looks like that. Eventually, it's deceptive. But then, a few of these technologies, not all of them, but a few of these technologies become disruptive. And when they become disruptive, like digital photography, just think about it. 1975 invented. Till 1995, deceptive. 1997-2000 starts becoming disruptive. 2011, the global leader goes bankrupt. Because what happens then? First thing it does is dematerializes everything. Dematerialize matlab physicality of the product khatam ho jata hai. Zarurat hi nahi hai. Distribution is dematerialized today. I don't need to have a physical store to sell my product. It's completely dematerialized today. We didn't have a role and a processing lab of Kodak in the market to get pictures and print. It's dematerialized today. Every single industry. Clothing will become dematerialized in some point of time in our lifetime. Then it goes to demonetization, because once it dematerializes, the cost, the marginal cost of creating that product is almost run down. And when it's run down, the physicality of the cost comes down. And because the cost comes down, it democratizes. So this is a curve every single brand in the world is bound to go through in different times. A lot of industry, data has gone through it, communication has gone through it, photography has gone through it, lots of industries have gone through it, hotels are going through it, travel is going through this already, almost on those phases there, and a lot of other industries are going to go. So if you're in a traditional travel and traditional hotels today, you have to worry about it, because soon it'll be demonetized. Staying today in Paris, I can get a place for $10 in 10 minutes, or Earlier, I used to book it well in advance, and there was no chance I could stay at that kind of money. Yeah? So everything is getting democratized today. Every single industry, and not just this, 3D printing, IR, I've given you some examples. Solar energy is today cheaper than oil. They say that oil will run out far before you and I think there. I'm saying Stone Age ended not because stone got over in the planet. So oil age will end not because oil will get over. Yes, something else will take over. And that's the part that solar is going to play. And the funny part here is about the change is that what we have seen till now is only 1%. In the next 10 years, what we're going to see is 99% of it. Why? Because that's the rate at which the internet devices are going to connect. And when internet devices connect, they do many things. Yeah, because it creates great, and that's when humanity starts lagging. Because you cannot control your watch talking to your mobile phone and your mobile phone talking to your physician and your physician talking to a different device, and then you cannot control that. Because it's outside our purview. And once it goes outside our purview, human intelligence will make those machines create value that you and I can't imagine. Think about the cameras today. There are 40 billion cameras on the planet today, yeah, including satellite cameras. They're going to go up to about 400 billion in the next 10 years. That's why the camera costs are really run down to peanuts today. 40 billion cameras are 8 cameras per capita consumption. All of us have 8 cameras today on our head, somewhere. There is no way the world is not watching everything we are doing with a resolution of 1 meter today, if they want. And that's what world we are getting into. If this is going to go up 100 times in the next 10 years, everything you do is wake up, sleep, there's somewhere some camera is going to watch us and it's going to get recorded. 99% of disruption is ahead of us, and internet is the true global ecosystem as we go. The diamonds being made today, the technology, which is scarce, would be made as good, and even the best judges can't do that, which is scarce technology at $5. Yeah. That's what we can do, $5. And this technology, the De Beers, is like keeping it under the feet, because like Kodak, because if it comes out, it's going to demonetize diamonds. Yeah, and then everybody will have diamonds. So the whole industry destroyed. Think about every single thing. Everything is now Uber, Amazon. There is going to be abundance of everything that you and I have known. We're getting into the best time this planet has ever been. We'll have abundance of everything. Water will be free, energy will be free, food will be free, education will be free, because everything is going to get demonetized in the next 10, 15, 20 years. Now, something. For example, in 1944, I think the entire planet will get lit by solar energy. We'll not need an ounce of any other energy. Yeah. And think about that's the price performance of solar. So if 2044, that's going to happen 25 years from now. In 2045, two planets can get lit. In 2046, four planets are going to get lit by solar energy. That's the price performance ratio that's happening. So clearly everything is going to be. We are going to live in a lifetime where, I don't know how many people know, Germany has so much of surplus energy through this technology, renewable energy, that this Christmas they paid back people to burn energy. Because the storage cost of energy was more than burning it. So you actually lit up your homes, everything, and you get money back. Government, acha tumne acha kiya. Sabse zyada bijli jalai, bijli khapat kiya. Ye lo 10,000 rupaye. That's the world you're getting into, because the storage cost is not feasible. It's better to throw back money at the customer. That's the world we're getting into. Clothing, this is an article, last month, and it obviously worries me, but cease with it. What happens when clothing gets demonetized? What does Raymond do? It's a very tough question, because eventually we could have digital skins where in your mobile you can change and say, oh, everybody's in yellow, I forgot, and I will just change the mobile application. Everything is yellow because digital skin. And as I keep saying, level of opaqueness is to the customer's discretion. Yeah? How much do you want to do? So it could get into that era. So how do you really run and demonetize, and how do you play for that? So this is the era we're getting into. First, oversupply of everything. Ownership is going to come down. The car ownership, they're saying, will be dead in US in 2025. You don't need cars. Yeah, so there's going to be much better way, far better economical way, more convenient, more luxurious to travel, and to the customized way the customer wants to do that. Production costs are coming down. I already told you this whole VAPI and this example that I took. Virtualization and decentralization is going up. These are the three key drivers in the disruption era for all the brands, at least for the next 5 years, and these are also going to change. There's a world of virtual and digital connectedness, which is obviously there, and the next, I think, panel is going to talk about it. Just in time delivered, you don't want to own it, I just want it then, and just give me then. I don't want to go wait, I just want to wait for even checkouts out of a store. How do you just give me walk-in, walk-out kind of service? And I think Amazon has done some pioneer work on that. And hyper-customization, these are some of the things that are happening. So this is given. Marginal cost of supply and marginal cost of demand, both are being driven down, and that's creating the market power velocity. Its consumer is bored. Enough consumerism already. And this is what is happening now, the next 10 years, this is what will happen. Only thing which was coming down was time. Resources and options were going up. Now resources and options will go up exponentially, and time will also start going up. Because then you don't need to own and keep and wait and everything. All three things are going to go up. 100% this is the trend that we are seeing in the era of disruption. How do you market in an era where there are enough options, enough time, enough resources there? How do you become a marketeer there? So how do you manage the brand? And that's the last part I'm going to talk about in another 5-7 minutes and really finish there. These are the three things I want to leave you with. If you really want to become a sustainable brand, that's my view. It may not be the authoritarian or a recommendation here, but it's just sharing my perspective with all the learnings that we are having. First is really to envision something beyond the matrix of our current brands and marketing. And I'll talk about this a little bit. Second is, why wait for others to disrupt? Self-disrupt. Yeah, it can demonetize, but so be it. You don't want to be a Nokia or a Kodak. Yeah, so self-disrupt. How does that happen? I'll talk about it. And building ecosystems. Yeah, that's another way of sustainably. And there was something that Pidilite talked about, echoes a lot with building ecosystems. And in fact, even the Nerola presentation talked about that. So what's happening? The whole era is getting extremely volatile. We're living in VUCA environment where time is compressed today, complexity is very high, new actors are emerging. Let me show you a picture. All this couldn't have been a headline of any of the global magazine 5 years back. None of them. Trump didn't exist in our lexicon beyond Trump Towers in New York or a project announced in Bombay. This Kim Jong-un obviously was not even an entity at that point of time. Or gender or floods or Putin's strength is only going from strength to strength. 2012, he was almost told that he won it by corruption. And today, it's 80% popularity for this man. In Russia, and virtually seen as the next conqueror who will make Russia to the superpower of the world. Things like those were not existing. So what's happening? Look at this for a change. The first time in the history of time, no person is the person of the year. It's Me Too, hashtag Me Too. Yeah? So it's a movement which started with technology platform, and that's the person of the first time the person of the peer is not a person of the year. Yeah? That's what is happening. So the first thing to do is to define the purpose of our brands. And purpose of the brand is, why do I exist? What is the purpose of Raymond? What is the purpose of Kodak? And I think this is where, at some point of time, could have been in hindsight, it's very easy to say, but may have been the miss by the Kodak team. When they said that, okay, here is a technology digital, in 1991, apparently it was presented in the board of Kodak, that this is a digital technology, this is the future. And they said, okay, how do we make money? And we make money through commercial rolls, and we do it through processing labs, and we do it through our cameras, and this is what it is. Analog photography is the model. And they said, this is free, or almost has a threat of becoming free. So I said, let's not get into it. Because our purpose was locked here for the brand. But that's not the purpose. The purpose of Kodak was preserving moments. Now, if they would have really got preserving memories, photography is not about camera rolls and processing lab. It's all about in humanity, in emotional terms, it's about just preserving a memory. That's why we click photographs. If that was the purpose, if a board would have used that to seed the decision, digital was preserving memory in a more competitive way, more cost-effective way for a brand called Kodak than the camera rolls, and maybe the decision would have been different. But that's not good enough. A lot of brands have great purpose. Nokia had a very clearly defined purpose. Our purpose is connecting people. We will connect people. Then we need to connect people the way people are getting connected in that era. You cannot then get logged to the way you want to connect people. Nokia was logged into Symbian, which is obviously a software which, or the operating system which got disrupted by Android and then iOS. These are the two things which disrupted. Or they got logged into multimedia phones. Now they said at some point of time, this is a discussion, obviously is my personal experience, Nokia got locked into saying, we are creating a world of multimedia phones. So let's make our phones better on music, better on camera, better on this. But then you're about connecting people. And so just by having purpose is not good enough a guarantee that you are going to live with that. Okay? So we discussed what is Raymond's purpose. I'm just giving you my example because obviously this is a brand that I can talk about. So we started this work here and we said, are we about cloth, Thaan, Meter, Raymond shops? Or are we about something else? So we are about wardrobe solutions. But are we about wardrobe solutions? We are probably a big... And then wardrobe solution, if it's about a digital skin, so be it. Why is Raymond not offering a digital skin? If it's about a design, why is Raymond not offering a design? Kind of a thought process there. And then finally, why do we exist? What is the deeper motive for Raymond to exist? Is it about making people look good, or actually because they look good, they feel good? Those kind of questions, and they're not think that, they're not concrete answers, but at least there is an exploration journey that we are going to. And that's the phase that currently we are in 2017 to 20, we're trying to do and then build the organization further. The second thing I want to leave you with, most of the brand and marketers are really, my time is up, but I take another 5-10 minutes just to build the concept here. All of us know we work with 3 to 5 year plans, and I'm actually standing here with a live telecast saying 3 to 5 year plans are dead. Because we are living in super VUCA environment. Things change. Everybody in this room, I can pretty much vouch for you on your behalf, has never had a plan which is static for 3 to 5 years. You would have changed the 3 to 5 year plans every year for the next 3 to 5 years, again, you change it. Because assumptions change. So to make and commit resources 3 to 5 years ahead of time and the strategy is absurd. The way it works is zoom out and zoom in, and that's what I'm actually recommending and proposing to the team here. Zoom out is, once you're clear with your purpose, you are about preserving memories, you're about connecting people, you're about making people feel good because they look good. You say, okay, 2030, 2040, I don't know, 10, 15 year horizon, whatever seems okay, we will continue to be about preserving memories in that era. And then come very quickly to 6-month horizon and work to make sure that milestone, whatever is there, is being done while you're managing everyday business. Anything beyond a 6-month to 12-month horizon is ridiculous at this point of time. How to measure zoom out and zoom in is very important. And that you should decide. And look at nothing else. Nothing else. Zoom out, zoom in. Zoom in is the metrics, and look at nothing else. Second, so that's the first thing. Second is self-disrupt. I'll give you an example how you're trying to do that. Why don't we disrupt ourselves before somebody else disrupts is the point I'm trying to make. And the way to do it is very simple. It's a chart again. Put your business value chain into 6 Ds. Every single value chain, every single node of your value chain must go through this filter to find out what could be digitized. Because anything in your value chain, if it can be digitized, it is getting digitized. So it's better that you digitize it, because very soon the deceptive will become disruptive, and disruptive will demonetize, and the thing will go away. Supply chain. One of the biggest capital block for Raymond is supply chain today. 30% of my cash gets blocked. Because textile is about supply chain. So in producing, doing inventory, stock, you go out, you need to have 100 designs and 100 products there because you want to choose one of them. Why should I have 100? Because you eventually will buy just one. You will not buy 99, and it's not that 99 are getting sold in the next minute. So all things can get disrupted. Yeah. So these are the thoughts that really go, and then you say, how do I do that? And once you do that, then you really start saying, how do I do that to myself? Is the point. So what we did, and again, I'm taking a Raymond example just to illustrate. Don't think that we are right. I'm not trying to propagate anything, but taking an example to illustrate my point here. We picked up 4 months back. We did this next generation conference about next zoom out conference in 2017 October. And we picked out from there, it was only for under 30 people in Raymond. Nobody else was allowed. Only, all channel, across the country, global partners, everybody's under 30. If you're 31, you're not allowed in that conference. To really dream and create a possible zoom out scenario, because they're living in a different world. Out of that, we picked up 12 bright minds of Raymond, and we told them only one brief, derail Raymond. This is the only brief you have. Come back in November, present to the chairman and the board of the company that if you're given as much of money as you want, hypothetically at this point of time, assume you have all the resources and technologies at your disposal, just go and derail Raymond, finish my company. Finish a node of my company, finish one value chain of my company, digitize, democratize, demonetize, whatever you want to do. And these people came with 3 ideas in November. Yeah? So there are 3 teams which obviously got formed, and they said, okay, there could be 3D printing which could disrupt, potentially disrupt. Not that everything is going to work, but potentially the team feels that this is possible. Another team which came and saying, how do we eliminate physical retail? We take a lot of pride in Raymond saying, I am the largest physical retailer with 1,500 Raymond stores in the country reaching 600 towns. They're saying we can eliminate it in 1 year. You don't need any of them. And still we'll service the customer better than you're doing. Possible. And how do you change to selling looks and experience rather than selling kapda and functionality and designs and style? Yeah. So that could be another way of disrupting Raymond. I'm not going to take through the recommendation, but just to say that that is one way to do it. And look at this. This is the last 2 months. This is some pictures of Mr. Singhania, Raymond chairman, interacting with each of these technologies about how to disrupt Raymond in 3D, physical retail, and the last one is really eliminating the looks and experience. That's the president of suiting business there toward the end. So all then the next job for a marketer and a brand is to really seize the imagination of the board and the chairman and the CEO and tell them, please come. I'll tell you how our brand is going to get disrupted. Not because of the brand equity getting indexed in MP or Gujarat or my share being less. This could potentially threaten us. Yeah. The second part of this is never mix. This is a mistake we all make. We always try to get these new ideas with the core business. Never mix it with core. Such ideas, if you put it in core, will die in no time. Because corporate antibodies are very strong. To really say not invented here and push it. Transformation in organization is a political process. It is not a logical process. Don't believe anybody who says it's a rational process. It's a political process. And in political process, you don't want to get disruptive ideas getting subjugated or derailed because of the internal dynamics, human dynamics there. Keep them away. Satellites, scale edges, not with the core, separate. And once you do that, use a skunk work method. What is skunk work? Skunk work, small teams, 3 to 4, 6 people, like little startups. So we are formulating a company called Raymond Ventures Limited, in which we are just taking these people out or getting people from outside, actually, and putting a few people there in each idea, but never more than 8, never less than 3, yeah, and multiple skilled people. Very different, not textile, maybe technology, maybe supply chain, maybe blockchain, whosoever comes there. And then starve the, that's the second mistake we make. When we are a big company like we are, and a lot of industries are, or brands are, we think, hamare paas kya hai? Startup ke paas paisa nahi, hamare paas paisa hai. Toh $2 million diya, idea ke liye. That's the biggest mistake we make. We should starve the edge. Because the moment, shortcut to success is never money. Never. It's always the idea. And by putting money, we are starving the idea. And hence, we need to starve the edge. That's the third thing we need to do. And then it has to be seen by top management. Because otherwise, it gets killed there. These are some mantras about, you know, how do you disrupt? Because if you start disrupting with this structure, it has some chances to succeed. But if you disrupt with some other structure, nothing because of the disruptive idea. Because of the structure itself, it will get killed. And the last one is building an ecosystem. Some people talked about it, and it's very important. Because we were differentiating our brands on our content, our products, and our service, and a lot of brands are stuck here. But believe me, every of these areas will get digitized. These areas will get disrupted. Patanjali will come and take away all some of these things. And so will happen to, you know, Ola's of the world will happen to each of these brands in their own respect, in their own category. The moment we start, then what does a brand marketer do? He starts creating entry barriers for even technology and disruption to come in. How? By creating platforms, by creating ecosystems, and not just that. And let me give you another Raymond example before I end. What we're doing in Raymond is to create a huge tailoring ecosystem. By a loose definition, till about last year, we had 5,000 tailors attached with 500 or 1,000 Raymond shops, 1,000 to 1,500 Raymond shops. So 3 to 4 tailors per shop. Ek tailor hota hai, karigar hota hai. So one master tailor and 3 karigars. So 4 to 5,000 tailors. And we said, the biggest bottleneck today is a shrinking tailoring ecosystem, and what can we deliver which others can't? It's customization, it's a tailored cloth. Could we dramatically increase it to 1 lakh tailors in 3 years? Because the moment, it's like painters for Narrowlock and maybe the car painters for Pidilite. So we looked at that. And not just that, we really go and then totally upskill them, raise their capability, raise the technology so that nobody can match that. Now, how can a technology beat a customization where tailor is trained, latest equipment, total dignity is restored back, economy is taken up? A tailor was earning 8,500 rupees before Raymond got into this last 12 months. Today, he's earning 18,000 rupees because of Raymond coming in and taking the technology up. So we create a massive ecosystem, not immediately 1 year. It takes 3 to 5 years to really do that. But who else than the market-leading brand to do that? So in the last 1 year, this is progress we've already made. We have set at Center of Excellence in our company. It's Thane. Anybody is welcome to come and really see. It's a R&D for the world of tailoring is there now. Absolutely the cutting edge tailoring. Tailoring advisory board with people from Savile Row in London are there as the chair of the advisory board right now. They're the ones who dress up the queen there. To 25 tailoring factories we've opened in 1 year. We open a factory of tailoring every 2 weeks. To a store every day. Raymond store coming up as a hub and spoke model. And then we are going into online tailoring where you press a button and we get a tailor sent to your house to measure you and deliver a cloth to you in express service in 48 hours to normal service, which could be 7 to 10 days. Now, a combination of each of these three things still doesn't secure a digital disruption for the industry, but it dramatically increases my staying power for a long time as a brand. Yeah? Because these things will take a decade for even digital disruptions to manage. So while we'll do that at the edge, we should do this at the core, building ecosystems. I look at Musk, Panasonic. Partnership with Panasonic surprised everybody. He's saying he's into car and what is he doing into batteries? But basically he was trying to make batteries cheaper because eventually battery is 1/3 of the cost of the car. So if battery is driven down because of the scale that he has and the vision he has, the cars will become cheaper, and the cars will become the cheaper or the cheapest cars, diesel cars or petrol cars in US or planet, and then suddenly electric cars is the only industry left. So that's what he's doing. And look how he's driven the price back. This is 2010, $1,000 is now $100, or almost $200 now. 80% reduction in the cost of lithium ion or the self-operated electric batteries which are used in Tesla. And now it's being used by Nissan and Ford and everybody there. Everybody benefits, but he's okay. He's saying, let everybody benefit. Look at the statement. We believe that Tesla, other companies making electric cars. He's okay with that. The world would benefit by a rapidly evolving technology platform. But what it gives Musk is the first mover in a platform which he controls and really puts his models ahead of everybody by the others catch up. And this is the way the electric car demand is going up. Dramatic increase. So this is the second part about this thing, is uncommon partnerships are critical. We must explore as brand. We're not used to it. Government, you never know where the big idea is going to come from. Is it going to come from government bodies, NGOs? We have a partnership with Cornell University now in New York. Fabric technology. Yeah, we're looking at startups. We're looking at some Imaginarium or a digital startup company in Andheri. Now, Raymond wouldn't have looked at it because we would have looked at Italian manufacturers, Chinese, big machines, big this. But you need to have uncommon partnership. We're looking at government agencies which are looking at skilling the manpower in India. We're skilling tailors. And that's an uncommon partnership for us. We're not used to it, but we must get used to it. That's what we're trying to embrace there. So that's the third one. Yeah? So eventually, it's about these three things to build readiness for the disruptive era. And I tell you, this is what I want to leave you with, this last chart. The greatest danger is not turbulence in an era of turbulence. It's acting with yesterday's logic. And the problem with human mind is to die for tomorrow's rational is not yet ready. So we need to take some punts, and I have given you some indicators of how to take a punt. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Behl, for that very engaging presentation. I'd like to request Mr. Ram Mehrotra to kindly come on the stage to give a token of our appreciation to Mr. Behl.
We have an excellent, thank you very much. We have an ad of Raymond which is not on air as yet. Let me put it, it's I think getting released today. I don't know how many people have seen it on digital, but just it's 60 seconds, bear with me. This is the latest ad of Raymond. Yeah? Thank you very much.
In black, I see things you don't. Flawless, like a knight that roars with elegance. Selfless, like a slate that wants to elevate every bit of your chalky musings. Fluid, like the drape that takes your shape as you conquer every cityscape. Hopeful, like the dawn that promises to spawn a yarn that makes the past. Black is quiet as a hush that says your presence needn't rush to make itself felt. Black is unapologetically creative, like a poet who doesn't give a dime about the rhyme as long as there's reason. I see restlessness. I see calm. I see a lot of things, and it all begins with black.
Once again, thank you very much, Mr. Behl. Thank you, sir.